Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 13 September 2018. The news articles we'll be seeing today are these six. Let's see them all in detail now. The first article is with respect to the topic of agriculture. Cabinet Committee clears new procurement policy. So the center, as promised earlier this year, has announced 15,000 crores in order to support the farmers who are growing pulses, oilseeds and copra crops to get minimum support prices for the crops produced by them. This allocation of rupees, it comes under an umbrella scheme called as PM ASHA, that is Pradhan Mantri Annadatta Ai Sanrakshan Abhiyan, which is approved by the Cabinet Committee of Economic Affairs recently. So this PM ASHA, it combines together other two schemes exclusively for oil seeds which are available in the market, which we'll be seeing them in the next slide. So by allocating this money, the government is ensuring that MSP as a concept, it works at a holistic way. So as we all know that increasing MSP is not adequate unless farmers get full benefit announced out of MSP. This allocation of money points towards right direction to ensure that the farmers get the benefit announced out of MSP. So the government currently announces MSP, that is minimum support prices, for 23 crops every year. And this year, in the budget announcement, the government announced a hike of 50% of the MSP, higher than farmers' production cost, which includes also the labor cost of the farmers. However, there is one limitation with respect to this MSP announcement. However, about one third of the crops procured by the center at MSP for the ration shop is by only rice and wheat, and the other crops among the 21 rest do not get any preference. So in order to address this limitation, the government has bought in PM ASHA for pulses and oil seeds. So under this PSS scheme, the government via NAFED and Food Corporation of India, they procure the produce from the farmers whenever it falls below the market rate, and the gap is of maximum limit of 25% of the total harvest is given back to the farmers via this scheme. And under this scheme, the center will bear all the costs. For the case of oil seeds alone, the states will also be able to choose from either of the two newly announced schemes according to this new cabinet approval. So the two newly announced schemes are, one is price deficiency payment scheme, another one is a pilot scheme. So under the price deficiency payment scheme, it is based on an experiment exclusively conducted in a place called as Bhavantar in the state of Madhya Pradesh. So in that place, there was no physical procurement at all. So instead, the farmers will sell their produce at the market and the government will directly pay back the farmers the difference between the MSP and the average market price as direct benefit transfer. So this cash payment will directly go back to the bank accounts of the farmers. So under the second scheme, which is a pilot scheme, it will involve private procurement agencies instead of the government agencies. So these private agencies, they will procure the commodities at the MSP for the government. So here the maximum service charges of up to 15% of the notified MSP will be payable according to the new policy. The second article we'll be seeing today is India's health report reads worse. So there is a new report called India State Level Disease Burden Initiative, which was recently released. And this report was released as a joint effort by Indian Council of Medical Research, the Public Health Foundation and the Institute of Health Metrics and Evaluation. So all these three institutes, in collaboration with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, with the support of experts and stakeholders, they devised this report. So according to this report, it put forward some worrisome trends existing in our country. So according to this report, the prevalence of ischemic heart disease, that is the heart disease dealing with the valves of heart and the stroke rate in the heart, has increased over 50% from 1990 to 2016 in India. And this trend is observed in almost all the states in our country. And the number of persons with diabetes in India, it also increased from 26 to 65 million from 1990 to 2016, which is also a worrisome trend in our country. And this rate of increase of burden of ischemic heart disease and diabetes has been highest in the less developed states like Bihar and UP, and wherein the burden of chronic lung disease and infectious condition is already high in those states. And the number of persons who are dying out of this chronic obstructive lung disease is as high as 2 times in less developed states when compared to the developed states in India. The proportional contribution of cancer to total health loss in India, it has doubled from 1990 to 2016 again. But the incidence of cancers in different types of states, it varies with different states. Another worrisome trend in India now is suicide is becoming one of the leading cause of death in India, especially among 15 to 39 age gap people. And suicide rate among the elderly has also increased in the past quarter century. So this report, it highlights the serious health crisis existing in country, and it also shows the disparity in the healthcare sector existing between different states, and it shows the needs for bringing in an inclusive healthcare system in our country. The third article we'll be seeing today is 37% of women dying of suicide are Indians. So this is a continuation of the report which we saw in the last article. The suicide is a leading cause of death in 15 to 39 years age group in our country. So 37% of such deaths among women globally occur in India, and the suicide rate among the elderly, especially the elderly women, has increased in the last quarter century. India's proportional contribution to the global suicide rate, which is called as suicide death rate, SDR, is very high, and it is even continuously increasing in past few years. With suicide being the leading cause of death in India in the year 2016, among the age group of 15 to 39, 71% of them who committed suicide were women, and 57% of them women. So this also shows the gender disparity among the people who are committing suicide in our country. The report also highlighted that the states of Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Telangana, which are among the group of well-developed states in our country, they show consistently higher suicide rate among both men and women. So this shows the link between the development rate and the suicides committed in our country. And if this trend continues, India will definitely be not able to reach its target set by Sustainable Development Goal, which is to be achieved by the year 2030. All these calls for a serious suicide prevention strategy in India, which takes into account these variations regionally and according to gender also, to address the major health problem existing in our country according to this report. The fourth article we'll be seeing today is Sage Advice on Raghuram Rajan's Suggestions. So we saw in yesterday's article about Raghuram Rajan's suggestion with respect to India's economic scenario. The former RBI governor, he cautioned India about the next financial crisis that could be building up currently and the need for the situation to be handled with utmost seriousness. In his note to the Parliament's Estimates Committee on Non-Performing Assets, Raghuram Rajan noted 3 major sources of potential trouble to our country. So the first source was due to the Mudra credit, which is basically small ticket loans granted to micro and small enterprises in our country at very low interest rate. And second is the lending to the farmers through the Kisan credit cards. And the third is due to the contingent liabilities under credit guarantee scheme for MSMEs run by SIDBI, that is Small Industries Development Bank of India. So this Mudra loans given to the small and micro entrepreneurs, it stands at almost 7% of the total outstanding bank credit currently. And these loans, which were sanctioned under the scheme of central government, that is Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana, it aims to fund the unfunded. That is to provide money to those who have never got money before, and those people, they were majorly from the informal sector existing in our country. Though this scheme was brought in to bring more inclusiveness into economic sector of our country, it is highly debatable whether the banks have enough resources and the manpower to recover these loans given to the small entrepreneurs. So these small loans given to many people, they finally build up into the radar and turn into a larger credit issue on a course of time. The same logic, it even applies to the Kisan credit card scheme and the other scheme mentioned by Raghuram Rajan. So as we all know, recognition is the first step in cleaning up. So unless the bank recognize the loans and clean their existing non-performing assets, they cannot start giving another fresh loans to new customers. And for this, Raghuram Rajan also suggested few reforms to be brought in for smooth functioning of Indian banking system. So the first reform is professionalizing bank boards with appointments done by independent bank board bureau. And the second reform suggested is inducting talent from outside the banks in order to make up for the deficit existing within the banking system currently. The third reform suggested is revising the compensation structure existing in the banks in order to attract best talent within to the banking system. And the final reform suggested by Raghuram Rajan is ensuring that banks are not left without leader at the top. So Indian banks, they suffer from leadership crisis which needs to be addressed in order to ensure efficient functioning of the banking system and its hierarchy in our country. So the central government must take note of these reforms suggested to ensure healthy governance in Indian banking system. The fifth article we'll be seeing today is Prison of Patriarchy, Why India's Female Workforce Participation is So Low. So India's workforce participation rate is one among the lowest in the world, and according to Economic Survey 17-18, it is revealed that women comprise only 24% of India's workforce. And in fact, as India grows economically higher, the number of women in workplaces are still reducing. So this is in spite of the fact that the enrollment rate of girls, especially in the higher education courses, it grew steadily from 39% to 46% from 2007 to 2014 in our country. So in India, it is observed that most of the women, they drop out of the workforce between junior and the middle management level. So they won't be able to progress to the higher leadership level in the companies in our country. So this is also economically verified by a management consultancy firm statistics, which pegged that this number, it stands at around whooping 50% in our country when compared to 29% with other Asian economies. So this drop can be attributed to the cultural baggage existing in Indian traditional families. So after marriage, women are prohibited from working outside the home. So they are forced to call off their work and stay back at home. So this phenomenon is observed even more significantly in higher income demographics. That is, it is more observed in the richer families when compared to low-income families in our country. So this is because in low-income families, the economic pressure, that is the poverty, it sometimes overtakes the social stigma associated with women going to work. So other reasons associated with low women participation in work is childbirth and taking care of elderly parents or their in-laws. Statistically speaking, at macroeconomic level, India loses of about 27% of GDP because of women not contributing to economic workforce in our country. So this is at macroeconomic level. At individual level, without any financial backing, women are forced to stay within the family. And this is also one of the reasons for India's low divorce rate because of lack of financial empowerment to women. So last article we'll be seeing today is retail inflation eases to 3.69% in August. So this retail inflation in our country, it fell below the target of Reserve Bank of India, that is a medium term target of 4% last month. So this inflation measured by consumer price index released by Central Statistical Office, that is CSO, it hit a 10 month low or touching of about 3.69% this August. So this low inflation is attributed to the low prices of the food products, that is vegetable pulses and even sugar. This is in spite of high fuel and light inflation, which stood at 8.4% this August, which is very high from its trend in July. The manufacturing sector also grew significantly, which is indicated by the positive percentage growth of index of industrial production in our country. All these data, they show a positive health existing in Indian economy and a positive expectation of India touching 8+ growth rate in days to come. Thank you.